Start recording. Hello everybody, welcome back to my level design retrospective. This is a stream in which I'm revisiting my old places of sin, the old, not quite literally sin, I worked on a game called Sin, but my old game levels, all of which were released at some point. And I'm playing through them somewhat sequentially, seeing what I feel about these levels today. My name is Matthias Voich. I've been a professional level and game designer in the industry, gaming industry, for the last 17 years. And I feel that a lot of my game design knowledge and game design sensibilities have been heavily influenced by the levels I've made over the years. So going back to this and understanding what exactly I was doing at that point and rediscovering it seems just like a fun thing to do. So today we're going to play the second part of the Troopers Playground. We played the first part yesterday and I think that was fun. That was quite successful, actually. Only got to level 4 though, so today I want to go a little bit faster. I want to not talk so much about the process of making levels and what it was like back then and so on. But I just want to play levels. So my ambition for today is to get through all of Troopers Playground at hopefully much better quality. I already see some people on the stream telling me that it is looking better, which is cool. Let's actually go out of here and so you should actually be able to read some of my readmes as well now, which is something you weren't really able to do yesterday. So yes, I think I have a whole bunch of technical hurdles which were figured out, and that should make it all the more fun to just pick up where we were and keep playing. Okay, let's make sure my background here looks really good. So this is what the Troopers Playground readme file, I guess, looked like. And there isn't really much more to look at, but I just wanted to make sure people could actually see what I was putting up here. So with much further ado, I'm going to go back to Troopers Playground, where we were yesterday. Turn it on right here. And let's go back and keep playing. So yesterday, here we go. So this is pretty much where I stopped yesterday. This is the end of TTP level 4. And I went into the secret, I found some stuff, and then I went into level number 5. So this is where I want to be, this is where I want to pick up. And I think everything should look okay on my green screen as well. There was a little bit of green screen actually revealed in the background, or where it wasn't fully covering it, but it should be all good now. Only found 50% of the secrets in this level, which is quite, well, not really surprising to me, but it's just pretty amazing that I don't remember all of this, right? So, if you didn't join us yesterday, you didn't watch my stream yesterday, I've played some of these levels in the intervening intervening years, but I certainly don't remember everything, and there's a whole bunch of stuff I don't remember about these levels, which makes it fun. While at the same time, I do feel that I remember enough about them to kind of tell you. So this is my Marvel level. This is a completely underground Marvel / River of Blood level. This might have been influenced by a really old module from Das Schwarze Auge, which is a German role-playing series, very much like D&D, for example. And there was this solo module where you infiltrate an old temple that has a river of slime going through it. And that's something that I always used. Well, it's a theme that I kept coming back to. So rivers of slime and blood and so on were all things that I kind of kept revisiting and might actually have been influenced by it as I was making this specific level. So I made some texture modifications, as you can see. I have like a nice black and white marble floor and so on. As I said yesterday, pretty much all of the extra textures and the new textures I have in here were all modified versions of an existing texture. I rarely made anything from scratch. I just want to make sure that it blends nicely into Doom, gives my levels a slightly more, I don't know, more shiny experience, makes it look a little bit novel without completely creating a total conversion or even partial conversion on this kind of stuff. Same goes for the status bar. I figured, hey, I should have a status bar on this, but it is a modified texture of one of the ones that you can find in Doom already. So here we are. Somewhat interesting choice for me to use the metal. This is actually a very tech metal texture right there as a trim. But hey, ultimately this works. So the idea behind this whole level, if I remember correctly, is to, well, you know, we'll just try to, and rediscover it. But there's multiple ways in which I can actually go about this. I actually want to go over here first, because put my center in the center of the hut, somebody says. That would actually be really interesting. I might try that out for the last stream, just as an Easter egg. Like, put me right where the Doom guy is. That'd be interesting. So, creating this right here, these kind of doors, which were, you know, you can see through them. You can't actually shoot through it. There actually was a way to do that. Dennis did this in Memento Mori 2. But all of these were hacks, right? This is nothing that you saw in regular Doom games, and this is nothing that... This is something that Doom level editors, like mod authors, slowly discovered and started putting into their games. It was a big deal. Scania is just a throwaway. But I'm sure I was very proud when I made that back then. I would like to say this, I made this level sometime in the middle of all of the levels I made for TTP. Certainly towards the... Yeah. More towards the end than towards the beginning, I would think. But even so, this is where I started picking up on all of these kind of tricks. So I assume I want this red key. And in fact, this red key will be used to get through this final door. I think it's the final door. So let's try to get the red key, and let's try to make it so I can actually get on that pedestal. So I mentioned yesterday how one of the things I love about level design is how you can always remember something about your life or what you were doing at that point. I very distinctly remember listening a lot to Deine Lakaien, which is a German dark wave band. Freaking awesome. A little bit like Depeche Mode, but not at all, I think. I don't know if they would take offense to it, but I don't think it fully characterizes them. They are definitely their own thing. I was listening to a lot to their album, which was like current at that point, which was called Winter Fish Testosterone. And just playing this now, never mind the music that's obviously playing, the Doom music that's playing here. I kind of have those Deine Lakaien songs stuck in my head right now. Remember. Now you can already hear, I don't know if you heard him well enough, you already hear that there's an archvile somewhere in here. I made sure, he comes into, he enters the field of play way later, but I wanted to make sure that as soon as he came in here, you heard him, because the Archvile was always one of those guys that you just, you know, you hated to see them in the scene. So actually, like, using that to foreshadow and make the player feel like, damn, there's one of those guys around the corner, is, you know, something you love doing. He references a lot, and, well, not a lot, but certainly a little bit with Wright Backwell, who was the creative director on Dead Space 2, that I worked as a level designer on. We talked a lot about the Archvile in Doom as like a unique soundscape, and in fact, there's a lot of commonalities between Doom and Dead Space 2 combat, not on the surface, but certainly underneath, which, you know, I'll talk about a little bit when I actually get to, let me backtrack here, get some health so I don't die. And when I talk about Dead Space 2, I'll talk about that a little bit, but there is this archetype in Dead Space 2 as well that can revitalize, create zombies pretty much, and we wanted to make sure that this guy had a certain sound signature and you were always aware of him when he was in the scene. So let's save the game here. Apologize if you hear something in the background. It turns out that somebody is doing their lawn outside right now, so you might be able to hear some tools in the background. Hello, Mancubus. In the background, you see the Dark Trooper, and I talked about this yesterday. So I made a new enemy type for this, and he was supposed to be this, you know, Doomed Trooper. It's actually probably what I called him. Like a lot of players who ventured into these dungeons ahead of time and died and turned into zombies, and you're fighting them now. So I modified the Deathmatch sprite and turned him into an archetype. Unfortunately, this version of TTP that I'm playing is not 100%, doesn't have 100% parity with how the installation would actually have worked out back then. So whenever this guy shoots at me, he reverts to his SS soldier self, which is not something you would have seen in original Trooper's Playground. He would have looked like that trooper the entire time, and he wouldn't have sounded like a wouldn't have sounded like a SS Nazi either. So yes, you have some people mowing the law outside my window. That's not something I can do anything about. As long as you guys can still hear me, I think I'm okay. We'll just take that as characteristic of the stream. Something to look back on. Somewhat interesting texture choice for back here. I think this might be a secret. Yes, nice. It just doesn't quite fit in, right? I have the marble here, I have these kind of wood textures here. I think this was the default texture that Wattad would assign to every single texture, so every single wall. And I think sometimes I just left it in place. So let's see what this did. Something good, I'm sure. Well, and in fact, I think that's one of these setups, right, where we have to do two triggers on both sides, but it doesn't actually tell you anything. I think it got rid of some of these bars here, but that's not very obvious. Made the level again today. I would try to maybe give the player a few more hints as to what is actually happening. What's going on here? I think I might have broken. Oh, there it goes. You're supposed to actually run over there. And that's how it works. Now, I can never vouch for how much of this worked in stock Doom and how much this is. I'm playing this in Z Doom, of course. So there might be some things where just Z Doom is better. You know, it removed some bugs or so, and this would not have happened in Doom. Or maybe it's just me as a level designer. I'm not paying enough attention back then. Okay, so now let's go up here and do what I'm assuming is me shooting this trigger, yes. So I don't remember any of this. I don't remember creating any of this. It's completely new to me as I'm playing it. I do remember this guy right here. Of course, we could hear him the entire time as well. Trying to take him out before he resurrects anybody. Scrawny little guy. Didn't really do much damage to me, right? Oh, man. Okay, so let's put that blue key to some good use. Let's go in here. This hallway right here, I specifically remember talking to my dad. So I'm sitting in my room the entire time making levels, right? And I'm supposed to be in university, and I'm supposed to be getting ready for life and trying to get a job and whatever. And instead, of course, I'm just making tons and tons of levels. And my parents were, they didn't fully get it. They didn't fully understand it. So this hallway here specifically is where I tried to explain to my dad what it is that I was doing here. And my dad has worked in construction, or more specifically he has sold building materials, like anything that goes onto roofs. Like in German you would say Dachpappe, for example, which is, you know, like the compound that you put on top, like the shingles you would put on roofs, for example, as well as any sort of skylights and that kind of stuff. So that's why I was explaining to him how I made this hallway. And no, I did not create the actual monsters, and well, I created one monster, but not more of them. But I was creating these environments. I was much more like an architect. And then looking at this, he pretty much said, okay, you should put some skylights in there. I didn't actually do that, because, you know, I think I'm too far underground. And you would have not have been able to actually see it. If this was a game in which you can look up and down, I might actually have done something about that. No, like, let you see the sky up above. But yeah, this was the specific room and a specific level I was trying to explain to my parents what actually what's going on here. I don't think they fully understood it until I actually moved. Even when I got my first job offer and I moved to Dallas, you know, I moved from Germany to Dallas. I don't think they fully understand what I was doing until, you know, I was there for a while and I could show them some Finnish games. But they were always incredibly supportive, which was nice. You know, back then there weren't any game design schools or anything that you could go to either. There wasn't degrees for it, certainly not in Germany. All my parents knew that a company in America wanted to hire me for what I could do. And they were willing to pay me enough money to easily support myself. So, that was cool. So what I never know, and this is interesting, this just... I think this is bad for Doom in general, because there was never a consistent language as to whether blood and slime or toxic waste would hurt you. I think lava always hurt you, but blood sometimes hurt you, in some levels it didn't. I had to check here myself, because I wasn't 100% clear. But yeah, that's something that I always have to test. But so this is where we're introducing this blood theme and this pool of blood. Just as importantly, hello there, two helmets. A little bit of a challenge at least. So this is a little bit of a anonymous trigger again, right? You have no idea what it did. The level does communicate, it gives some feedback, and it communicates some sort of change by spawning monsters and you being able to hear something, but it doesn't actually give you any information as to what, like exactly where that happened. Now this right here, like both with the blue key and the yellow key, they just kind of both appear and you didn't actually know they were going to be there. With the arch vial, I spawned the key and you couldn't see it before. Here I spawned those two barons of hell and I spawned the key. I think I could have done that a little bit better, just to create a little bit more, yeah, a little bit more foreshadowing and motivation. That would have been a little bit one of those doomed troopers, of course, but he's not actually... He didn't convert into one of my zombies. Oh, hello there, I didn't even see that guy. Okay, hello. Quite a few things going on here, so let me take out this guy in the back first. Said this again and again, I love the fact that, like, to me, Doom really works as a game. If you're watching the stream right now, or you're watching the video later, and you're watching me play, and you have an opinion on how I'm playing, and in your mind you go, kill this guy, go after that guy, why aren't you killing that guy, while I'm actually going for somebody else, and all of those different strategies seem valid. There are just different ways in which you could attack these different, in which you can actually attack the different combat encounters. I think that's when it really works. Can I shoot this from here? No, I cannot. This is interesting to me. We'll see if I can come back to this later. This looks like a destination, so I'll come back to that. I mean, I should be able to run into this. There we go. What did I open here? I think it's a leaf blower actually that's going on out there, so I'll hear that a little bit more. Okay, I'm not sure what that trigger did, and we'll come back to it later. I'm not really playing this as much with the map as I might. Oh, it's opening this door, I think. Maybe. Let's see. Yes, it is. And now you have to kind of make your way past here. Yeah, I think if I was to play this myself, I might use the map a little bit more to anticipate secrets and so on. You know what? Let's drive, jump down here. This is too much fun to just try to get some infighting going here. Oh, there's some arachnoids in here as well. I said this yesterday, I feel that, you know, I consider myself an expert Doom player. I've played this so much that none of these guys pose a challenge per se. I'm playing it on Ultra Violence already. I don't want to do Nightmare for all of the inherent complications that that brings. But I feel that, you know, as you're watching it, it might seem somewhat nonchalant. This might seem easier than, I think, the intended target group, for example. You know, just like pretty regular players where two Barons of Hell and two Techo Demons would have meant a serious challenge, for example. I am describing it to like Legolas in Lord of the Rings, so that's my comparison, right? He's just dodging arrows, just sidestepping them, it's not even a big deal for him. That's kind of what this feels like. It's still fun though, that's what I like about it. Even if I'm not challenged per se, it certainly is fun. And you hear those guys in the background the entire time, so you know they're gonna come out to play later. A little bit annoying to hear them as much as I do. And hello, there they are. Uh-oh. So this is gonna be interesting. This is actually gonna be a bit of a challenge. All of these guys in the room, and I'm not gonna use the teleporter until they're all dead. Get some infighting going again. Even just knowing the Mancubus shot patterns and knowing how to strafe left and right, and that not even being a question anymore. Where is the Arachnoid? Is he coming in later? He went somewhere. You know, like having learned all that and having that committed to muscle memory, it's just one of those things that knowing exactly how the Revenant missiles actually work, how exactly the Archvile, you know, that you have to break line of sight and so on. I think these are all things that once you grok it, it's awesome because you can play with it. It's not necessarily the experience that you would have had as a Doom player who wasn't completely familiar with all this. So as we can see, and this is where it's, unfortunately it's somewhat anonymous again, right? There's this really prominent trigger in the middle of this island that I finally got to... Oh my god. I did not realize I could get over this. That was really, really stupid. I'm not going to do it clip. I'm actually going to go back up there. So I think we just learned something here. That's why we keep saving as much as we do. But I have this prominent trigger right here that I just used, coincidentally enough. And it creates this river of blood, and it actually raises the blood in an interesting way, as you're going to see in a second, but there's no tangible connection. And I think I could have done a little bit more with that. Okay, let's get back. So I have no idea how to get here. This is going to be a secret that I will not try to solve right now. So I'm trying to make somewhat decent progress. I think I actually remember now where those arachnoids went. And we shall see. Yes, you hear them again? They went down here. So the river of blood is flowing now. You can see how there's a little bit of an artifact because I had to raise all of these to a certain height. You know, these are floors, which it's a light and depth that can actually raise floors and set them to a certain different floor ceiling type. But so now all the blood is flowing. It is going down here. It's going all the way into the bottom. And because of that, because of this, I can now reach this key. Now, I went down here earlier to actually see the key, and I'd actually forgotten it was here. I think this is pretty cool. I think this is pretty clever, if you get it. Hey, look, he's sliding on the blood. This is very cool if you get it. That doesn't necessarily mean that most players would have gotten it, because all of these like causal connections might have been lost. It's because, you know, you didn't play it, and I wasn't there to explain it. And ultimately, that's always my fault as the game and level designer, right? That's never the player's fault if they don't get it. Just the fact that the subtext exists, I think, is decent, though. Let's see what happens here. I expected something like this. Oh. Let's see. Well, that's not going to help me much, is it? And as much as I like Berserk, I'm not going to use this right now. I'm just going to circle straight the hell out of these guys. Maybe get some infighting going, but that's difficult. One of them is dead already. Yeah, let's just shoot at them. There we go. This is what Doom, just with its incredibly fast movement and, you know, this incredibly well done low-level systemic agency, as I call it, where you're just in complete control. The, like, the fine motor skills the way in which you are translating your finger presses to the screen is just 100% there. Doom could actually do these kind of combat setups without needing cover or a whole bunch of ways in which modern games work. It's really awesome. Ah, these guys, I'm not sure why they didn't wake up. But so I really had it. I think this is like the third or fourth exit trap that I had, and I figure I'm actually abusing that a little bit too much because it doesn't mean anything anymore. Every single exit feels like it's probably not going to be an actual exit. So let's pretty much move right on. Let me go to the stream real quick just to see if there's anything in here that I wanted to answer to right now. If not, we can do a little bit of a Q&A at the end or so. Neki asked, like when I was talking about the portcullis doors, when were the bridges discovered? I'm not actually sure. The first time I saw those bridges was when Ika was doing it in his levels, and then in Requiem, of course. I think somebody must have done them beforehand, but I'm not entirely sure. I never actually made one of them. It just wasn't really worth it for me, but yeah. Thinking of Dead Space 2 makes my eyes hurt. My eye hurt for a reason, the trap set. Yes, it's one of I love that part of it. I didn't work on that part at all. I can't claim credit at all for that scene, but it was pretty nice. Yeah, something that Pinch Scree says that, and I forgot this. You could actually set how much damage each sector does, right? So you could do 20, 10, and 5%, and you could actually then... But again, this was completely unstandardized, and everybody was doing it differently, which was pretty terrible. So I missed the secret rocket launcher. Yes, Neki. That's why I only got 33% of my secrets. I don't remember a lot of this stuff anymore. But this is where somebody hopefully goes back, and actually there's actually speedruns of this. You can probably find some YouTube videos of this, and somebody go back and actually go back and play my levels and 100% them, because I'm clearly not. So this is the third level I ever made. You remember how I made the TTP bonus map that I didn't become part of this? Then I made map 3, which did make it into this. And I think right afterwards, that's not true. I made map 8, which we're gonna see soon. But then afterwards, I made this level right here. That's how I remember it. I still remember it. I think generally, and you know, that's just kind of natural, I started making maps and themes, started choosing themes that I hadn't used before. So, after I did map 3 in this map, I probably made this space base, which is map 8 in this, and then wanted to go back to something that was more medieval or dungeonous or cavernous, so that's how I got to this. I think afterwards I probably did the map we just looked at that had all this marble, because, you know, I hadn't really done a marble map yet. That's probably how this stuff came together, and then in the end I just did whatever was required, what was necessary. You know, there's only so many themes that you have in Doom. Look at this, so that's one part of the puzzle. So at some point, of course, you're going to start repeating yourself rather quickly. I actually do have the rocket launcher from the last playthrough, by the way, even though I missed the secret. I'm just not using it, because I'm not a big rocket launcher fan. I feel that the hitscan weapons just give me more bang for my buck, and I don't have to worry about shooting myself. But yeah. Some of these monsters live in too small a space to actually be able to coexist, and that's why some of them get stuck. That was, in a way, Wadad's fault, because most editors actually gave you the right size. So when you place these guys, you knew how many people you could cram into a space. Wadad just had these tiny... Oh man. I missed a huge secret, and that's ultimately my fault for not going there. There's a huge secret in here before this get raised. If you go back in there, that's actually 200. Oh well. But so what? I just gave you these little icons, and it didn't actually tell you how big everybody was. And for that, you could easily cram too many people into one space. Oh, well. So I'm still trying to figure out if I'm pissed at myself or if I'm just, you know, that's just the way it is for missing that secret. Because clearly that platform coming up behind me was not something I could have anticipated. And I think a decent level designer would have made that a little bit more clear or more player-driven or made it a... I think you just made it a lift, for example, so you can bring it back down just in case. I think I didn't do that because I wanted the stairs to go up there in a nice way, but yeah. I hate it when you switch to the shotgun and you first get the double-barreled shotgun even though you didn't need to use it, but you have to use it because somebody's just about to blast you in the face. So there are multiple ways you can play this. This map is going to come back and I might not actually play it again. This map made its way into Requiem as map 9, I believe. I made some changes where the area you're going to see here, which is kind of anemic, I realized in the end, actually gets quite a bit more detail and a little bit more of a progression. But this was the original. This has, when we're talking about themes, also an interesting kind of clash between different sensibilities, because it's going to be a high-tech area a little bit later on. Now remember, this was the first map I feel I was comfortable with, kind of shown to people. So Dennis Müller, like Panzer of the Innocent Crew, was doing these series of what reviews, where you would just have text files that you could download, where he was reviewing a whole bunch of what's and giving them stars. And I sent him this map afterwards, just as a gauge. I think that might have been the first correspondence we ever had, when where he realized, okay, I'm doing this stuff as well, and I was telling him, hey, I'm making a 9-level episode and so on. But so I had him review this, and got good feedback. Now, you know, like, if you're asking somebody to review your stuff, I don't know how honest they're going to want to be. I love how this decal actually accurately wraps around. That is pretty awesome. That's not easy to do, people. Like an engine deck. But one of the things he called out was specifically how me going between this kind of medieval dungeon theme and then going to a high-tech theme is something that's pretty daring, and ultimately it works, but it's not something that you try to do all the time. It worked despite it not, you know, it's not necessarily something you should do. It kind of worked. So let me see how this worked out. Obviously there's a site here. Now in Requiem, I think I added one secret where you could actually go down there and that's how you got the key. That's not how it works here. I'm not entirely sure, actually. I don't remember it myself. This is, oh, there he is. Oh, we want to get rid of him. And ideally using my trusty shame gun so he can't spit out any more lost souls. Oh man. There we go, I got him. He actually got me through there. Okay, so what's this gonna do? Nothing. Wow. Like in Doom, you're trained to expect something to happen as soon as you step on a pedestal that has a key on it, right? There's just no way something's not gonna happen. Let's go down here and see what that gains me. And maybe I should have saved before, but well, here we are, stuck. Save right now. Oh, not good. Well, I could have done that much better. And I'll make it out of here alive. So that's kind of worth it, because I'm ultimately going to leave this with more health than I had. Alright. Feeling good. So I got a yellow key. I don't actually know what I need the yellow key for yet. Let's find out. Before we keep finding more keys. So up there you can kind of see the... It kind of works, you know, because there's more of a kind of slime sensibility. You can see the first inklings of the tech base theme. The Echo Demon just woke up and I have no idea where he is. I'm going to try to shoot all of these guys from up there. So, I have the yellow key. I need the yellow key for up there, but I need the blue key first because I actually need to be able to get up there. Little shotgun, nice. I was listening to a lot of death metal. I still do to this day, but I'm a little bit more picky in my taste. But I listened to tons. I had long black hair, which was dyed black. It's kind of goth, kind of metal. A lot of my map names in Quake were actually inspired by various heavy metal bands. But you know, it also has this kind of demonic sensibility, satanic sensibility. Of course, not for real. No way, you know, we really took that seriously. But just enough to have fun with it. And that's where he created all of these little shrines and places of worship and so on. Okay, so I just got another key. I also see a secret here. Look at this. Let's save right here, because I'm at a good spot where I'm at 100 and 100 for armor and health. And now that we have the blue key, this doesn't open. Once again, the affordance there is terrible. You could not tell that this wouldn't open unless you tried it. Foreshadowed here already is the fact that there is a red key, and I don't think there were many line devs, and I don't think many levels did this. I remember finding it and being so proud or being so happy that I actually found a line dev where you could use a switch that required a key. Using switches that required keys, you almost see never. Like, you always have actual just doors which are tagged with keys. So that's the idea here, that you're gonna need that key up there to ultimately open that door. And we just transitioned somewhat sneakily, I might say. I think it kind of works. Because, you know, I'm keeping the brown theme alive from medieval into tech. So this might have been just... This was not the first time I did tech. Like, all of level 8 that we're going to see is all tech-based. This was me revisiting it and going a little bit back into to Doom 1 roots. Of course, you saw a little bit of it in map 2 as well. Hello there. For some reason I remembered the revenants coming down, but I guess it's just pinkies. Every time you use a double barrel, that kind of made up for it. Every time you use a double barrel shotgun to kill a pinky and you don't get him in one shot, you always feel like a loser because you just wasted one shot of ammo. But then killing two with one shot is pretty cool. So I think that easily... that easily... adjusted itself. Same here. You know, you just want to use a single barrel shotgun, but if you can get two guys with a double barrel shotgun shot, you didn't really lose any ammo. You're still just as optimized as you could be. Just a little look back here. I do remember a secret up here. No idea why this little thing is in there. It makes it look somewhat interesting, right? Like, again, I'm looking at the detail in these levels, and as I said in the first stream, I don't think I really advanced much in terms of just detail level. I think it all pretty much has the same kind of consistent, I think, decent level of level of detail to it. This right here is really annoying, though. If there was... I don't even remember if there was a tag to... Well, yes, I should just have... You know, it makes it a little bit of a pain in the ass to create those sectors, but there should have been tiny sectors on the left side here that are set to not let the player pass, so that you don't run into these things like this. And the ceiling texture right here, and you're going to see this in level 8 as well, that's something I made. This was made from scratch, because you look at how simple it is. Look how this is just slightly misaligned. And guess what? That must be a secret. There's going to be some other... I'll talk about it when I get there. There's going to be some other textures that... You know, usually I was more like a scavenger than somebody who actually created stuff from scratch. So I stole from various games, or you talked about the Sky Dome in this. level pack being taken from Spelljammer. Yes, hello there. I don't even remember seeing this plasma rifle in here. Should have maybe highlighted that a little bit more so I would have remembered it. But so the Sky Dome was taken from Spelljammer. Other metal, other textures were, and flats were just adjusted from existing textures. There's some I also took from other games, and I'll tell you about that when I get there. You're gonna see a strong... I said this before, you know, just to give you a hint. Like, somebody asked me on the introduction stream what level, like, kind of what games I liked, and I said there's three games, ultimately, that if I have to go back to that really, really defined me as a game designer. One of them is Doom, quite obviously. One of them is Ultima, because I absolutely love Ultima. So you see, like, between Pools of Darkness and Spelljammer and Ultima, I was huge into role-playing games, still am. And the third one is Turrican. Turrican 2, specifically. And that gives you a little bit of a hint of where some of these textures coming up might have come from. Okay, so this is one of the most involved trap rooms I think I ever built. So let's go through this one at a time. So I want the red key. How do I get the red key? Oh. Start with the switch. The switch. I couldn't put it in the middle here, would have been nice to. Okay, let's get the key. Not a problem. Oops. And you could, by the way, you could glitch this. Like, if you really want to get around it, and you could break this as well. I think speedruns have actually done that, but for most players it couldn't happen. Okay, so I got a switch coming out. Well, then let's see what that does, because, okay. Something else open. Let's go in here. Oh, now I'm locked in. Now I have to fight. I like doing these kind of trap room setups when you have cackle demons outside, for example, where you just stand here and strafe correctly. Okay, so now there's another switch in here. What does that do? Okay. That does something a little bit, so I guess if I go down here and I open this door, hey, look at that, now I can finally get the key, right? Of course not. It's another trap. And where does this trap leave us? Lead us. I think there's guys in there, let me try to take them out. Safe real quick, not because I'm really worried, but... go from one to the next pedestal here, taking these guys out. I think going down here, and there's obviously a teleporter down here, just in case. I don't think it actually gains me anything, so I'm going to stay up here. There might actually be a... let's just do this. Yeah, it just gets me back. So, I don't think I'm actually missing a secret here. I'm sure I already missed a whole bunch of secrets. Okay, so what can I do now? Oh, I can finally... wait. I can go around this way, because this one came up. So clearly I'm gonna get the freaking key, of course not. I can't think of many games. I love this. I think this is cool. Like, I still like it after, you know, after all these years. But there are a few games in which you can make these kind of setups and create this kind of level design, right? So finally, I believe. This goes up again, and yes. But of course, triggered a guy. One last little trap. One last little middle finger to the player. In a fun way, I feel. But yeah, I can't think of many games. You know, Painkiller obviously could do these kind of level setups, but this was all about just having fun with setups and with spawning and a simple room like this transforming itself into something completely different. That's, I think, where I feel Doom excels, and that's why it's so fun. Hey, and look at this. This altar with this demonic face in there. Ultimately did have a purpose. Now, I don't think I actually have to kill these guys. I could just run in here, because the exit is right there. And I'm pretty sure this exit isn't booby-trapped either. But for completeness sake, let's try to get 100% enemies. Before I leave. And here we go. Good. Okay, so here we go. I want to keep playing pretty soon, but see if there's anything on the stream. Neki talking about how you can do quick weapon switches, but yeah, I don't want to do that, and it doesn't actually work for me. My middle mouse button isn't working correctly. Key control switches were introduced in Doom 1.9. I don't think so. I think it was 1.666. I think that is entirely correct. I only ever used 1.666 when I was making these levels, and 1.9 only at the end. But yeah, I think they were added for Final Doom, maybe. That might be entirely correct. So, yep, this was indeed. And, I might switch it for Requiem in favor of some other levels to look at. But maybe we'll go back to this level just to see what I changed about it. Okay, so this is where my dehacked patch is not getting 100% applied again. Because between the background, this should actually be a different background, and I actually created a text for this as a. I think it was very simple. It was simple, like, I think it says something as really bad as another stupid intermission for another stupid story. What are you doing? Why haven't you already pressed the space button? Go and kill more guys, or something along those lines. And then drops you into seven. So I wasn't really trying to build a world here. I wasn't trying to take that seriously. I just, pretty much just told people, keep playing. But so this is map 7, and this I must have made pretty late. Not very late, but one of the last maps that I made. And what's interesting about all of map 7, of course, is anybody. Okay, why am I using a double barrel again? Everybody who actually knows Doom is that there were a whole bunch of line deaths and things that you could do that only worked in map 7. It was hard-coded into the Doom executable when you played Doom map 7. There were things that would trigger. Specific like sectors could be tagged to do something. Either when you killed all the mancubuses, whatever, I think it's mancubi, I'm gonna call it that, in the level. And that would, I think, raise something or lower something. We shall see. Also, the arachnids that we have in here, in this game, would raise or lower something as well. Now, this also works in map 7. I'm making use of it. Now, I think it's a little bit lost again on the player, certainly people who aren't actually making Doom levels, because what is happening here and how the level structure works because of it, only people who make Doom levels are actually going to understand. But so I'll show you how all of this works out. That was terrible. I just strafed into a fireball. Okay, so there's a blue key here. Let's see what I want the blue key for, huh? For this? Nope. Blue key I want for up here. But since we're in here, hey, you know what? Let's engage with these guys. Let's use some of those rockets that I haven't been using. Two rockets per arachnoid. Let's see what happens when we kill all of these guys. Wow. Wow, I just got weaned. Need to get health back. Okay, I'm gonna. There we go. Let's get some health right now. I like the additions. I didn't like Doom 2 that much as a game because I didn't like the level design that much. It was trying to be Hell on Earth, it was trying to do those kind of levels. I found them to be just pretty uninteresting, really. So I never really played Doom that much as a game. In fact, I never finished the main campaign, I think. But I feel that the additions they made to both the weapons, which is just a double-barreled shotgun, but the double-barreled shotgun has such a huge influence on how you play the game. And the enemies they added all added hugely to what you could just do in the level design. And that's where something like the arachnids, for example, were a good addition. Because, the plasma gun wasn't really used enough. Was purely a player weapon in Doom 1, and adding that and giving it a certain threat profile and a certain character as a result to that enemy was important and actually worked out really well. I am kind of skirting the edge here a little bit with how much health I have. Hey, look at that. And yes. Neki says, this is the typical Doom sound. If you had to make one typical sound to identify a game by, it's this. looking for secret doors. Also happened in Deathmatch a lot if he wanted to do a silent BFG, which is something that, okay, so I will come back to this later. So I think this works out actually by going through the level of progression. There was a bug slash just you could overflow the sound buffer where two sounds cannot play exactly at the same time. Whenever you would play Doom 2 Deathmatch, we always played Doom 2 Map 1. In fact, we had a national Doom League going that I was managing via FidoNet, where you could call people up and you could challenge them, and you would play Doom 2 Map 1. You would always try to get, if you had it, well, if you had the BFG, you would always try to get that silent kill going around the first corner. And you would do that by doing the use key against the wall and trying to fire the BFG exactly at the same time. And when you did that, the BFG was actually silent and the enemy player wouldn't hear it, and it was a little bit easier to actually kill him that way. Yeah, so this Doom 2 leak was called Doom King. We did it via FidoNet. We had over 60 people, I want to say, at the end of it. And it was very much like a challenge league. It was a tree where, you know, somebody at the top. It was a pyramid, really. That's what you would call it. And, how do I get this? Oh, I have to go up here. Oh, hello there. And hello, whoever else just arrived. So I'll point it out every single time we see these guys, because if you're just joining the stream now, these guys are broken. They're not supposed to be SS Nazis. I think they would have been terribly out of place. They're supposed to be doomed troopers. But yeah, so it was a pyramid on Doom King, and if you could always challenge everybody to the left of you, up to one row above you, or to the right of you, whatever. And you would actually call people up. You needed a modem, and you could do it once a week, because that's how we managed this. This leak. Let me get out of here. Kill these guys. And then you had to use Doom 0.1666. Whoever was challenging was the guy calling, and had to, you know, pay for. Ouch, that was not good. Had to pay for any phone costs, which were somewhat in Germany in the 90s. It was not fun to make any sort of long distance calls. It was incredibly expensive. But yeah, and then you would play until 10 frags, and you would do that in Doom 2 Map 1. And of course, you would, as you're doing that, try to do the silent BFG as much as possible. So I have the blue key, which means I should immediately go up here, right? But I'm kind of drawn, especially when coming out to this area right here. So let's just see what we can find on this side. First of all, this guy's up here. I was at the top of the Doom King for not very long, for a little bit, but there were people who were better at Doom Deathmatches. I was usually like between rank 4 and 7, I believe, of that league. Sorry, I'm just pausing here real quick to catch up on my chat messages. But yeah, we had a lot of fun like playing this again and again. First Doom Deathmatch I ever did was against a neighbor, and we did a null modem cable. So, and this was in Doom 1 still, and then we played a lot of Heretic. So we would just carry our computers back and forth between two houses, up and down the stairs, everything, the big bulky desktop, small monitors, but really heavy CRT monitors and so on, and that's how we would actually play. Lost most of my health here, but just doing a null modem cable, which is a serial cable, right, that would go between both computers. But then afterwards in Doom 2 we actually had our deathmatch league going, and it was a lot of fun. I'm like looking back to it fondly. No, it was a lot of fun if you remember who I was, because this was in 95 and 96, and I was one cocky little bastard at that time, probably still am, tried to mellow out a little bit with age, looking for some health here. But you know, you had a lot of people who were in high school or, you know, college age. And, of course, the way we were communicating and the way everybody felt, like, everybody felt that they were the shit. Oh, most of them. Some people, I want to give credit to everybody who wasn't. But so, there certainly was a certain edge to the competition. Also, if you talk to my friends at that point and how I regarded myself as a level designer, I was God's gift to the world when it came to level design. right? Like these levels, and I don't think that's really true, but that's how it came across. Ultimately, the ambition I always had for myself for all of these levels is that they should be as good or better than its maps. I wanted to make something. If I have all the tools, I have everything that the creators. Damn it, there's one more guy. Okay, I'm gonna save here and it might completely bite me in the ass because I have 7 health left. Let's see, there he is. But I figured that if I have all the tools that the makers of the original game have, then I need to hold myself to that standard. And everything that I make needs to be at least as good. I think that's a really good way to look at everything that you do in game development and elsewhere as well. And you know, if you're hobbyist right now, making mods or so, you have all the tools, hold yourself to the same standard that the people actually making these games were holding themselves to. And ultimately, I think that benefited the quality of these kind of levels. So get, here we go again. And I hope it's somewhat visible. It's actually easier. This is something that you realize when you become a professional game developer. You do not realize how easy it is to mod something. Oh, look at that. How easy it is to mod something, how hard it is to make something from scratch and actually be a designer while the engine and the systems and the game design is coming online. This goes for Quake as well, right? Like, once you have the entire game and you go back to this, this is why DLC is usually so much better. Because this is where you're just making the game you wanted to make all along. But if you are present, I'm not sure if this is actually physically correct for how the light works out here, by the way. This looks like it should just be lit everywhere. Anyway. And I actually died. Making a game, doing game design while the game is in development is just so much harder than doing it after the fact. So that's why DLC is easier, more fun to do as well. And that's why it was possible for us to actually go in here and make levels that I feel we're not just on par with, but might actually have been better than some of the stuff that you see in Doom. Like, as I mentioned, I don't like Doom 2's level design that much. I'm not trying to bag on it too much, but, you know, I feel like we had some really cool stuff in here. That's mostly simply because, let's be prepared this time, because we're working with a finished product. While, in fact, I made this in 96, right? Like, it was already, oh man, it was already very, very busy quitting Quake at this point. I feel this trap is a little bit too hardcore. Not necessarily sure I agree with this trap 18 years later. Oh, look at that. I spawned guys into those rooms again. Sneaky little buggers. I'd certainly say, you know, like with Doom, this was the first time. I mean, I used the 3D construction kit, and then I used other Mechadem Bumper, actually, which was this pinball construction kit back in C64 days. But Doom was certainly one of the first times when, as an amateur guy, you could just make stuff that was on the level professionalism that anybody in the industry would expect, and then Quake for sure. And because of that, you were actually able to, you know, pretty much create your own calling card in a way and show people in the industry that you might be somebody who can actually work in the industry. And I mean, that is 100% true today. In fact, it is so true with all of these 3D tools all being free for non-commercial use. You being able to just download my, I'm a Softimage guy by heart, so you should still download Softimage, even though it's been discontinued, but it doesn't really matter, right? You download Softimage, Maya, Houdini, 3ds Max. Like, all of these tools are just 100% available, and there's no reason you shouldn't be going out right now, Unity, of course, as an engine, and just make a game that has complete professional quality. Oh man, I missed the switch before I came up here. And then as you're doing that, that's the one, and I don't want to be too preachy about it. But certainly say, the one standard you should hold yourself to is to make something that you would actually pay money for, or something that's as good as any of these games that you might admire. I think what I'm doing here, by the way, jumping over these guys, is only possible because I'm using Z-Doom. In normal Doom, you would have been blocked. You could not at all go over people. This would have been a good little secret. Another switch on the other side. It's akin to that adventure game trope where there's an open door and you have to close the door to find something that's been pinned to it. So let's keep going. There's a pretty obvious secret here. The reason I remember this secret anyway, let me kill everybody first here to make sure I'm somewhat safe, is because this is a secret where me not testing the level a lot, or not really having my own QA, only doing my own QA, I guess, really comes back to haunt me. Because what can happen, I'm not even going to show you. You can go in here and you can close this door, or it can close itself, and guess what? You are stuck, because this side is not tagged. And the only way to get out of it, this is what I'm going to do, I'm not actually going to load the game again. You had to it-clip through it, or you had to reload your game. So that's a pretty bad secret right there, because you could get stuck forever unless you know the cheat. Can I shoot this? Probably not. I can probably teleport myself over there in some shape or form. All the way around to haunt me. You know, those fireballs, that is, which have some heat-seeking ability, but not ton. Okay. So, I still like this map. You know, I'm just kind of playing along, talking about it, having fun. It's actually cool. I feel that what I talked about earlier, how this is map 7, where I can use arachnoids and the mancubi, in interesting ways. It's not at all obvious to me yet. I'm not even sure. I know it's gonna happen soon. And I will know how. I'll show you how. But you know, it's just a fun map to kind of go through. In fact, I've had the blue key the entire time and I haven't used it yet. You know, just as I'm coming out. Okay, so here's another mancubus. So the way I feel this was set up is that you could go two directions. You could go behind the blue key door, or you could go in here. And you had to kill a mancubus at the end of each one of them. And only by killing them would the sector actually, like you would see it later, would you actually be able to make progress in the end, because the sector was affected correctly. So as I'm going through here now, I like this as a setup, by the way. It didn't completely work. Let's see, I actually died. I didn't even mean to die. So if I run through this as quickly as possible, there's a way in which I can kind of play this. Or spawn frag, I guess, I thought, more people than just that one guy. It actually teleports me all the way to the other side. Gets two archvals in here. Okay, maybe I shouldn't actually. I'm so gung-ho about it because I want to show what happens. You know what? I should just kill these people from back here. I did this again in Memento Mori, map 18, by the way. Oh man, that was not... I should have dodged that one. But I used that kind of archvile trap again. Okay, now I'm just making a fool of myself. Still is correctly here. But yeah, I did this in Memento Mori on map 18 as well, where there was this room that you would just spawn frag a whole bunch of guys and they would just be dead, a whole bunch of really high level guys, right? And then I would bring an archvile into the mix afterwards. That's kind of what this is doing. We decide how well it works. Okay, so at least you can hear them already. And I just completely forgot, I should have used this here, that I have the plasma gun. Oh well, I'll use it later for... And here we are. Oh, so, okay, so... Let's celebrate my plasma gun right here. And here we go. Little pepper. Just undid all of my work. And again. Now, you don't see it in here, the actual world levels that used this intentionally. There was a zombie bug, right, where the Arch file, and I don't know if they fixed it in 1.9 or not. If a guy died exactly under a door and then the door closed, he would get gypped. Like, in other words, he would only get like a little pile of blood that's left behind. But then if an Arch file came in and we created these guys, we couldn't kill them anymore. Of course, there was a bug. So I think there were some mods and some levels that actually used this intentionally to create an army of undead that could not be killed, to kind of just push the player forward or do something with it. I never did anything like that. I did use the Arch file in one interesting, actually a very interesting way in Requiem map 15. We'll talk about it when we get there. I was kind of proud of it. I have no idea how many people actually got it. But just as a little bit of a, that's not even a teaser, but the only way to you could get to the secret maps in Doom 2 was through a flag that worked in map 15 specifically, right? So whoever did the map 15 in these megawatts was also the guy who would create the portal to the two secret maps that existed in, hello there, in that game. And I had map 15 in Requiem, and so I tried to do something with the Archwell there. We'll get there. It was probably still very advanced again. It's very like emergent kind of gameplay, very much like rocket launch, rocket jumping and so on, all things that were not necessarily foreseen by the original developers. What you could do with the Archwell and the zombies and so on is certainly stuff that Stock Doom didn't have, because those guys were already making... Oh, look at that. Wondering, I think again, because of maybe Z-Doom or not, and certainly because of Wadet, these guys are stuck to the point where they cannot actually move correctly. And that might have been in the original level pack, but again, it's because in Wadet, I did not actually see how much space these guys had to take up. Okay, so a lot of these advanced things that we're seeing here only were available to people who are making levels afterwards and actually discovered all of these things that as a level designer, as a game designer, you already passed, because, well, if you're making a sequel to a game, you might find it, but generally you're already on to the next thing. Oh, and that's right, somebody in the on the chat for Shock Blaster said you could only kill these guys using splash damage or shock damage, where you had to use a rocket launcher or something like that, because then they would actually take that. They would take, you know, blast damage, but you could not actually shoot them directly. So here we are. And here's the other Mancubus. So he's on this side, and now that I've killed, once I've killed both Mancubi, I actually ran into that. I'm so proud of knowing exactly how that shot pattern works and being able to sidestep it. Until I don't actually do it correctly. Yeah. I think rocket jumping actually was already somewhat... So how do you go down here? I don't remember correctly. How did this come down? What am I missing now? Because, so this is ultimately the teleporter which would get lowered after killing everybody. But am I stuck in my own level now? Is something not working? Am I not doing it correctly? I mentioned the player never is wrong, so the designer, in this case me a little while ago, screwed up. Is this not working in Z-Doom? Am I just missing something? Does somebody on the stream know, on the chat know? Because I was pretty sure that this is what you had to do to lower. Well, I think there might be one Mancubus missing, but if that is the case, why can I not do it? Why did the blood not lower either after I killed those Arachnites? This is interesting, it is a mystery, and I'm only gonna look so long. I don't want to be the guy who on the stream just keeps, in a somewhat comical way, just keeps looking around his level forever and ever. So I might just cheat my way through this. Well, the auto map doesn't tell me much, because everything is already... Well, I can see all the secrets, which is interesting, of course, yes. But, as you can see, I pretty much... I've seen everything. Neki just said on the stream, you know, look at the auto map, and yes, there's... a secret. Hey, look, I haven't been to that one. Okay, maybe that. Maybe, I'm sorry, maybe you're entirely correct in that I should not have doubted you, and actually is something that I did not do yet. Which, I mean, I'm still a kind of terrible level designer for making it that hidden, but you're entirely correct. There is, it looks like, another room in here. And just to, you know, like if we're really doing a level retrospective, you see how there is a... There's still some grey rooms here that I have not actually been to yet. Like this one right here. And I just did not use the freaking switch. So that is game design circa 1994 to 96. But really, it's me being, I don't even want to say a bad level designer, maybe I have a little bit less patient on the stream than what I would have as an actual player. There's definitely a chance of that. It was somewhat hidden, yes. And let's see what's going on here. I think this is where we find number 3. There he is. Okay. Perfectly lit with no visible light source. Well, you can't see it anyway because you can't look up and down. Should have probably put some sort of light source up there. Oh, and it's just me turning the light on. Okay, but so this actually lured, and as I'm entirely mistaken, lured the boss around the teleporter just at the start area. And this is because I killed all 3 Mancubi. Now, again, as I mentioned earlier, this is not something that I think you would have been able to appreciate unless you're a level designer. Like, the causality between this, it, you know, if it's out of sight, it's out of mind. And if you don't see this, yeah, it might as well not have existed. Anyway, let's move on right here. Let's pick up a lot of rockets. And I actually remember what happens here, right? I'm just kind of setting the stage. Let's see what actually does happen here. I was incredibly conservative with how I used these really big enemies, like a cyber demon or the mastermind. In fact, there's only one of them in my entire map. Because I feel like if you just put them all over the place, it's kind of like you have alien queens all over the place in an alien movie and they just start fighting each other. You kind of cheapen the entire thing. I used Barons of Hell and various high-level enemies early on, but I then try to save these kind of guys for very special occasions. I think in Memento Mori 2 we actually had it set up so that you have a mastermind and a... Oh my god, did you just see how I completely screwed that up? That was terrible, wasn't it? I was doing so well and then I strafed directly into the rocket. So in Memento, let's do this again. In Memento Mori 2 I think you actually got them fighting. And again, okay, I'll pay attention to this just a little bit, because it's actually pretty easy to play this if you know how to circle strafe and all this, but yeah, that doesn't mean that I don't have to concentrate just a little bit here. So this is the only cyber demon we're going to see, luckily. Good, because he already killed me twice. And got me with some splash damage there as well. I might go as far as safe progress through this fight. One thing I never liked about, let's save right here, one thing I never liked about these cyber demons is that because Doom doesn't have any sort of damage states, it is very hard to see if you're making progress towards this guy. Of course there's no, here we go again, there's no health bar either. So I know that I'm doing damage, right? But I have no idea at what state in his life cycle he is now. If he's at 50% health, 33% health, or whatever. There I go again. Okay, one more time. This was actually perfectly synced up. As I'm looking at the stream and the time delay upstairs, I had just died on the stream, just to die again on the stream. So there was red on both screens. But I feel that's something that's missing here. Like, it would have been just so much nicer. So to save our way back, to actually get some sort of signs and feedback as to how close this guy is to dying and how well I'm actually doing. Save again. And here we go. Okay. So I think I died a few times too many here, like as a seasoned Doom professional. I don't think this is something that I want people to put on my tombstone, but hey, I defeated him after all. You compare what I just did to the first time you see him in Doom 1, and how many time it takes you, and he really feels like a complete boss. Like a complete boss, that sounds kind of weird. But you know what I mean, right? He really feels like a guy that you will never defeat. He retained some of his ferocity there. But, you know, he just wasn't quite as scary. And now, look at this. So, something closed up there, which I think is my portal out of here. This is me. You can tell that I definitely made map 8 at this point, because this is me connecting this map to the map that's going to follow, which is going to have an all-tech theme. So this was map 7, and let's finish this and go to map 8, which is the last map. There's map 9, of course, which is the boss map, but it's going to be a rather quick affair. Well, we'll see how long it takes me to actually... how long it's going to take me to actually defeat John Romero, the demon in the middle. But, yeah. Okay, so, look, there he is. I should probably just leave if I can, but I'm trying to take him out. Okay, and that was map 7. Now let's see how well I did on secrets on this one, since I actually had the auto map. And look, 100%, perfect. Okay, let's go to star control. That's what I called this now. So this is, as I mentioned earlier, the map I made right after I made map 3. This is also, if you watch the intro stream, I'm probably not going to look at these maps on the main stream. Look at the intro stream. It's also a theme that I used for two of my deathmatch levels, or one of my deathmatch levels only, where I actually tried to create something. I think all of this was influenced by Dark Forces, like the Star Wars FPS. We'll see it later, where I wanted to create some kind of hangar-like environments. So I guess the story behind it, there isn't really one, but the story, if you will, is that we just teleported into space using the very important portal that the Cyber Demon was guarding. So you know what, let me just take a quick break here and look at anything that was on the stream so I don't create too much of a backlog. So Mancubi, the BDC says Mancubi had a sector that could lower something. Arachnotrons, race. I keep calling them arachnoids, by the way. I guess the official name really is arachnotrons. But, yep. Dimensions 9. So, yes, I'm just reading through all of the comments right now. I think I'm just going to keep going on. There's been much debate on the quality of Sandy Patterson's Doom map design. Yeah, I really like Sandy Patterson as a designer and the sensibilities that he has. I didn't necessarily like his 3D maps. That also applies to Quake and the fourth episode. But you know, that's personal. I know some people who love him to death because it has this kind of Cthulian thing going on. So the Cyber Demon takes 4,000 hit points with a rocket launcher. And yeah. Okay, so let's keep going on and go through pretty much the last level on this. I remember this map somewhat because, you know, I spent a lot of time tweaking this and working on this, and I did not send this to Dennis, for example, you know, talking about I held it back for my map pack, and I think at this point, and I have no idea exactly how I hit on these, like, I don't know exactly when I hit on the fact that I wanted to make it a map pack, but it must have been sometime early. Wow, that actually is a secret. I had no idea. That was just me totally guessing because it had this interesting, you know. It must have been sometime pretty early. After probably I made this map, I already had map 3. And I probably made map 6, the one we looked at before. Map 7, haha. Funny how that works. At that point, I made the choice to go the whole distance and make 8/8.5 maps. And create all of this. There actually was a... let's talk about this real quick. I just realized that I don't really use a lot of exploding barrels as a level design trope in my maps. You know, you can do a lot with them. I never really used them. And there, they didn't do anything. There is a, and you can find this on my homepage. It's just www.vorch.com. W-O-R-C-H.com. If you look into the Dooms retrospective and you look into some of the posts, I found a different new enemy I was making for this. It's this kind of reddish fish dude, which never made it anywhere. I think he was supposed to be a melee type, a bruiser type. And I discovered the watch for it like a few years ago and just posted it. But you will see him in this environment as the screenshot. This is exactly where you would have seen him. And I guess if I had kept everybody alive, or maybe going through this, this might have been a really interesting trap. But yeah. Because this is a... it's a space base in many ways. You saw one of the custom icons I made. I'm gonna go back to it in just a second. Let's go back to it right now so I can talk about the Doom Trooper. So that's a teleporter icon right here. It isn't open yet. Made that specifically, and then the way that textures in Doom actually work out, I think they're the lumps, but I'm not entirely sure. You would, instead of just making new textures from scratch, you would actually make smaller parts and then combine various textures into a new archetype, right? So this one right here would be something like that. But so, I talked about this on the last stream. When I made this Doom Trooper, which you can see right there, when he's not trying to attack me, I wanted him to be this kind of archetype that you would be definitely afraid of, and he was supposed to really stand for something. He doesn't really do that. One of the ways in which I was trying to make him do that is by having him pick up items, ammunition, and weapons, and so on. Which, of course, doesn't really work. I turned it off anyway, because there was a major bug we're going to see in a second. But it just didn't work because nobody was aware of the fact that he could do it. But it was this flag in the Hackett where I realized they could actually do it. I don't think it just ever used. But so, the reason why I turned this off is because, look at this right here. Imagine this guy's being able to pick up items. And imagine how many people got stuck right here when a Doom Trooper would just go pick up the... new key, and nobody ever knows this about it, and there's a bug here and you cannot actually continue. So let's kill him, because he's not that difficult anyway. I'm going to say it again for anybody who's just joining the stream that there's a bug here where he reverts to his normal self, which is the SS Trooper. He's supposed to be, of course, a Doom Trooper the entire way. But yeah, he just looks so out of place. I just have to say that every single time. I understand it's kind of repetitive. But yeah, so now I have the blue key, and that's why I turned it off. And that's ultimately, I think it was TTP 1.1 or 1.3 where I actually realized that this is what was happening. This right here is the kind of space hangar aesthetic I was talking about earlier. I was trying to create that. Now these wall panels are incredibly simple. They're supposed to have a kind of simplistic, I don't know what kind of aesthetic, like plastic or whatever. But yeah, so you see there's a new railing type up there. It's actually all pretty crude. I would not say this is on par with the textures that you see in Doom in the first place. But yeah, I only got to use it in this level. And then, of course, I used it in the deathmatch level as well. So I want to go up there, but I need a yellow key. And there's a There's an elevator in there. So let me just try to take the guys up there, out up there in the peanut gallery. So I don't have to worry about them. That was a nice shot. And keep going this way. So the floor here is a custom texture as well. And this one I'm sure I made from scratch just because there's not much to it. It was inspired by Ultima 6. A whole bunch of the flats were little sprites in Ultima 6. Because, you know, if I had to only pick one item, like really just one game or one franchise I could take on a lonely island, that's all I could take, I would be hard-pressed to pick Doom. I think I would actually pick Ultima. Ultima to me is the number one, like, kind of formative experience for me. And of course I take the entire series. If you really put a gun to my head, I think I would have to go with 7, even though that's really tricky. Because it might have to be 6, it might have to be 5, even 4 for so many different reasons. But anyway, a lot of these flats that you see right here were inspired by Ultima, because if you remember what that game looks like, it has these kind of tiles. How are we doing on time here, by the way? Okay, about an hour and a half, which is pretty good. I think we're pretty much in line. Wanted to keep it to an hour and a half to 2 hours. I think we're going to be closer to 2 hours, but I think that is totally fine once we're done with this level. So what I want to do after this, play the last level, of course, and then just get a sneak peek into Memento Mori so we can play the levels next time around. There's another teleporter. I think the teleporter exists because I'm cutting off access to parts of the map down the line. This is a really unimaginative hallway. I don't like myself having created that. It just doesn't have any personality at all. I think it could have been done better. This entire room is kind of empty as well. It's still my early map design, it looks like. Just taking this guy out, but it's gonna be worth it. That's a rotten trap. I did not remember this one. It's kind of cool. Ouch. Uh-oh. Take this guy out, and let's save and find some health, yes? Because I'm gonna need it. And the fact that I didn't put any health in here, that's not a good level designer. I did not look out for myself right there. I think, okay, we'll just go forward and find some help. Yeah, so this is a new texture I made as well, which is like this hangar kind of thing. Not perfectly aligned, of course, because the only way to actually perfectly align flats in Doom was by staying on the grid. He had no control over how they aligned. So he tried to just move all the stuff. But yeah, so this should have been a warehouse, right? I see one crate here, and we know that every single good first-person shooter needs to have a warehouse with tons of crates. I could have made this that warehouse. I just didn't. Is there anybody up there, by the way? Or if not yet, maybe? We shall see, because this looks like a perfect... I mean, you know there's going to be somebody in there, of course. Oh, I guess there are people up there. And they're impossible to see. That's probably those imps that I keep hearing. Okay, well, let's be heavily aware of that as we keep going forward. Somebody is taking me out. No, I'm not sure where that shot came from. Let's save again. Let's see what's happening here. A little bit of health, good for me. There they go, now it's getting populated. You can even see them spawning in. Not sure why I'm spawning those guys in instead of just opening a door in the back. Maybe on the alternate? No, that doesn't really look like it. I had tons of space in the back. I should have done that. Oh well. Not really important. here we could go in this direction, and this is where the yellow key is. Oh man, hello. Again, I think as a better level designer, I would have elevated that key in some shape or form, so that's actually visible from below, and I actually have a destination and a goal. Okay. Let's pick up the key before we accidentally jump down again. So I think now, let me see. And if this is going to be incredibly obscure again, no, it's still closed. I think these doors just open at some point. So I think this is a secret, or if not a secret, then it's certainly something I haven't done yet. I think I can shoot that switch up there to get something. This entire part of the map that I missed, which, let's see, it's actually probably relevant. I like my Lord of the Rings references, you know, comparing this kind of playstyle to Legolas just dancing around the arrows. This right here is where I'm turning into Gandalf in Mines of Moria. I have no memory of this place. I have absolutely no idea. I'm just going to where the draft, where the air doesn't smell quite as foul. Because that's really all it is. So let's see what this does. I'm not sure why all of these are actually... interesting. So yes, I have no memory of this place. So let's keep going on and see where that actually leads us. So let's see. I mean, again, you're looking at the detail level here, and I think this is where you might see a little bit of a progression through my career, because I don't think I would have let these kind of rooms stand. They're just a little bit too barren. And more importantly, they don't have any sort of implied purpose, even. You know, like, it's hard to make something. In fact, I think it's kind of a fool's errand trying to create actual real-life science fiction environments in Doom. Even Alien Doom, which, you know, was the one that kind of, like, showed people what you could do in the engine and the kind of atmosphere you could make, only could take it so far. So, I didn't actually want... I think this is all just bonus area. Interesting. But you can imply certain uses, right? And you can just give it a general implied sense of purpose, which these rooms are not necessarily doing. So I have no idea what that switch did, and I'm sure we're going to find out at some point. For now, let's use our shiny yellow key and go upstairs. So I think once you come up here, so this is where the switch comes up. So this is another specific flat that... was heavily inspired by Ultima 6. If you go in there, you'll just know. I don't think this is a blue door. It is just a weird light I made, which is somewhat misleading. Maybe it actually is a blue door. So I got the blue key earlier. But yeah, I'm not sure. So let's go up here, round everything up. This is where we... see another teleporter. This is the teleportation chamber. Okay, so this is where now you can actually, I guess, go back and forth with the rest of the level. So let's see where this gets us. Back to this area. Doesn't really serve a purpose. Oops! Gets me back into a different room. Good to know. I think there's one destination into it. So this is where I can go back and forth between the level now. Kind of cool. Not really necessary, of course, but hey. What did I know back then? That should... well, shouldn't really be a secret. This should be a secret, because it's the one... not really, they're both... there's actually symmetry there. So never mind. Okay, so now let's go. So this is me using trickery, right? And this was me... remember, this was still early on in my career. This is where I found out how you could actually make the Doom engine do a whole bunch of stuff that... doesn't really... oh, man. Embarrassed for walking into that one. But yeah, so this is where... oh, this is broken. This does not work in Z-Doom. What's actually happening here, in actual Memento Mori, in TTP, we're going to keep playing this. This key is at the bottom. And you feel you're going to run in here. and gonna fall into that, and you realize it's some sort of zero gravity or whatever thing, and you cannot pick up this key until you go all the way down to the bottom. So we're gonna play it as if that is what is actually going on here, okay? I did not just get the red key. This is where, and like, I've never played my entire level pack in Z-Doom. That's where you gotta be careful with all of these ports from today. There's a whole bunch of stuff that doesn't actually work exactly the way it used to work back then. The way you did these, I don't even remember exactly how you did it, but generally all this trickery was based on creating incomplete or invalid sectors inside of sectors, or sectors that were connected to other sectors. So if you looked at this in a level editor, this being that room, that ZOG room I was talking about, you're probably going to find a whole bunch of line depths on the sides of that room. Ooh. Hello there. So this is just, I think this is heavily inspired by what Romero did in map 2, E1, M2. You know, this is one area in E1, M2, which is just computer panels everywhere. I don't think it's actually doing as good a job, because it doesn't have any sort of height differences. Well, it's pretty much just a classic maze, right? And if we're looking at this with one destination in here. I have so much health, I'm kind of splurging right now on my shotgun ammo. And there's nothing even in here. I think it's really just a kind of afterthought. So you have a couple of those in my level here, and you make the argument that's cool, because you get some bonus areas, and it's not all just about one linear progression, which I certainly agree with. Because there's nothing to these areas, though, it feels like they're just a little bit lonely. They're a little bit, just, again, they're lacking purpose. Now, this is actually a secret, I believe. I cannot get this stuff. And I will have to find out how to get up there. Yeah. So, the entire setup here. Now let's actually do this, because I think that's a secret. Allows me to go up here. And now, let's see, there it is. Slightly offset maybe, but maybe not really. I think it might just purely be by inference. You have to look at the map to realize that, hey, you can run up here this way. And then you cannot actually go out here again, which is kind of annoying. Somewhat inconclusive, let's put it that way. So the idea is that... Oh, and this door doesn't open yet. The idea was that, you know, this red key was below me the entire time. And there's another side to this, I just noticed. And I think that's where we actually turn off the zero-G. Now again, if I'd been a little bit smarter, better game designer, I might have like created some zero-G signs and actually created some sort of explanation as to how you're going out into, I don't know, whatever the switch room is out here, to turn off the zero-G so you could actually float down there and get the key or something, but yeah, that wasn't to be. This room too is very barren. I'm not necessarily proud of these, looking back at them after all these years. In fact, I could probably have, you know, like, gone with a zero-G theme instead of just looking at it as some interesting trickery. Made this entire thing zero-G, where you're walking on, you know, in the middle of the air. But yeah, what do I know? So, here we go, that's a switch. That also opens something back here. Let's take care of these guys first. I heard them. And now let's use the switch. Here we go. At least I did something with the lights here, so it wasn't completely wasted, but it's just still a pretty barren thing. So I already have the red key here, of course, but the idea is that I would just have seen the red key, and now I would come out here, actually have access to this part of the map. And now I would pick up the key. Now this, of course, is also how you made those bridges, right? The only difference was that it was a invisible like collision elevator, which then had, through some additional trickery, a line def in the middle, similar to all of these, oh, I don't have one here, all of these kind of gratings you put between windows that made it look like a bridge. Save again here. Pretty sure, and they already are there. So, fortunately, they're not saying the right thing, and that's two doomed troopers. And here we go. We're somewhat inspired by what the Innocent crew did in Obituary. They did a couple of clever things, I believe. Because, you know, in Quake you could just create new enemies, but here you were stuck with the existing enemy types and then had to do the hacker. So they changed the Hell Knight to become the Imp. So he was an advanced Hell Knight who would actually be throwing those. Where am I? Interesting. How did I get up here? I did not actually mean to do this yet. So the Imps, there were no Hell Knights in that episode. They only used Barons of Hell, but I think that's something you can definitely do because those guys are just, you know, one guy is a little bit. Weaker, exactly half as strong as the other one. So all of the imps were throwing green plasma balls or like poison balls or whatever. And then they changed the imp to become a splatter guy. They made him look like a guy holding a rocket launcher, and they changed the fireball into a rocket. So he was called a splattering trooper, right? And that's what the Doom Trooper was supposed to be to a certain degree. Somebody that you see there that you're actually really afraid of, because there's two guys there now shooting at you with rocket launchers. They're just not quite on paying off on that. So let's save again, let's look at the stream again real quick, and then do the final map. Tanaka says that all versions of Watered until 1.8 displayed a misaligned grid. I only started using it at 1.81, I feel, so that's why I... I only used it afterwards. So, the BDC, the downloads on the Patreon seem to work. That's interesting. So Polygon Mine was actually something, was a domain I used to use, but it might not work again. So if you go, I will check this out later, you should be able to download all of this stuff at www.worch.com, W-O-R-C-H.com. If you can't, I'm gonna come back and make sure my links are actually fixed, because I might not have that domain anymore. So let's go and see how we can delete. This is delete, not quite literally, how we can get rid of General Mao's head. So, I don't even have a demon, there's no semblance of it, right? The idea is just that you shoot these windows, and the guy keeps going up and down. So as he goes up and down, you shoot while completely ignoring. Oh, you saw his face. He's kind of going back and forth. And you're trying to actually... It's trying to make a bit of a puzzle out of the entire thing. But it only works so well. Go back up, go back up, go back up. There we go. And that's how I did it. So, while everybody is spawning around you, I might go back and just show you again at least what's going on there. I feel like, you know, I was kind of trying to finish this map. I didn't want to do the big demon head, apparently. So I tried to come up with something that was a little bit more in line with, you know, what you would see in space, and that's the idea here, right, where he would spawn all of these guys out of mine outside up here, so you can deal with them, while you would try to, as the actual head goes by, try to kill them. And of course why those cube spawners were creating problems for you left and right. I actually just did it on my first try because I know what's going on here. You might make the argument, I would hope so, that if you don't know what's going on, there's a little bit more figuring this out and it has a little bit of a puzzle element to it, but I wouldn't call this the best map, like end map, that you would ever play in Doom, but this is how this actually ends. So that is the end of TTP. That's how my level pack ended at this point. Back then. And you know what? Maybe with a little bit too much of a whisper instead of a bang, we could make an argument for that, but certainly, you know, I liked it. I mean, just even going back to it, it has a certain resolution to it, to me. So, that was my first release. I released this on Fidonet initially, then I put it up on CD-ROM.com as well. I talked about that a little bit yesterday. And yeah, so what I want to do now, so first of all, going back to the stream, if you want to download my maps, if you go to www.voich.com and you actually fix those links, which I will try to fix as soon as possible, you can actually download my stuff and play it. You should also be able to just download in a whole bunch of other places if you search for the Troopers Playground, of course. Finishing this level pack got me some attention with Dennis, you know, and Thomas, who are both Germans as well, so that certainly helped and allowed me to then contribute to Memento Mori 2. So Memento Mori 1 was the first big megawatt, you know, that was Team TNT, who then sold out to id, and honestly, I didn't like that megawatt that much. I didn't think the quality was really all that good. I feel that with Memento Mori, you got something that was better than that for no money. But Memento Mori 2 was at that point already in production, and Dennis contacted me and gave me a couple of maps if I wanted to do them. So I pretty much transitioned straight from making levels for Troopers Playground to levels for Memento Mori. And those are some of the levels, you know, and then Requiem that I wanted to go back to and just play as well, because I think you see some progression there as well. I don't want to do too much of that in the stream today, so this one doesn't run too long. But I did want to go just into showing you what Memento Mori 2 really was all about. This was us pretty much, you know, like the creme de la creme. Oops, and of course some overlap here. The creme de la creme of what authors, people who actually made maps at that point, all contributing to this one single thing. And I can actually put this up here right now. Everybody was looking forward in the Doom editing community for Memento Mori 2, right? And I think ultimately we delivered in it as well. It's free, yes, it's free for everyone. It actually had a lot of separate deathmatch levels. I think the best deathmatch map I ever made is in one of my Memento Mori 2 levels. And as you're going through here, you see how you could download it and so on. Now, this is something that, you know, if you want to download it, you can read the README. What was interesting about Memento Mori and where I think this map in Memento Mori, this entire megawatt was standing out a little bit, is that Dennis also created a info pack for it, which was called MM2 Info. And I just want to show you just for a little bit what that looked like. So this was a separate download. It has some backstory here, which, you know, we're not going to read all. Could actually, you know, if you want to download it, you can run it in DOSBox and look at it. But so it was this little info pack. And what's interesting about this info pack is that beyond just having the backstory as well as author bios and bios and so on, Memento Mori Operation 2, here we go. It also had two additional maps in it. Memento Mori 2 actually had 34 maps. You know, like a typical Doom 2 ward is, of course, 32 maps. But the DAT file, the supposed data file that came with this, was actually secret maps. If you renamed it from DAT to .WAT, you could actually play them, and you had two additional maps on top of the 32 you already got. So let's see if this is actually coming up or not here. Like, going into the actual... Here we go. So, it's actually cutting out a little bit at the bottom, but you can see all the important stuff. This is Dennis and Thomas, like the two innocent crew guys. Coming up with stuff. Now, I don't remember what the password is. I think you could just enter whatever. But I do believe that there actually was a special password you could enter, and I don't remember what it was now. I just remembered it that would allow you to... I don't know what it did. Maybe it told you how to get to the secret maps? I don't remember. But so here you go. So you had an actual... we had an actual info file, which is going incredibly slow on DOSBox, which got you information to all the maps. Let's see if I can, this is so slow, actually get to the first of my maps. No, because I went between sectors, so let's try to go back. But I think this was kind of cool. And this is the kind of level of professionalism that we tried to get into back at that point. But yeah, now at this point you have to remember Quake was pretty much just around the corner. Q-Test had already been out. And, you know, like, people who were playing Doom at this point were a lot of hardcore Doom players, but I think they still had a really big following. Requiem probably was like the final, like, big goodbye. A lot of people might have moved on at that point. Requiem was delayed for so many reasons I don't want to get into right now, but you know, so it came out at the very tail end. Of course, people kept making Doom mods, and there's still an entire entire community around it even to this day. But I'm saying, like, you know, the usual playing public at this point had peeled off. So here, for example, you can see Sector 3, Agent Assigned Matthias Voigt, that's my old email address, which definitely does not work anymore. And then I was coming up with like a little bit of a mission description for it as well. And there was probably a way to actually zoom in and out on it, but none of this works here. But yeah, so that's what the info file actually looked like. So I'm pretty much done with this stream. I want to pretty much dive right into Memento Mori next time. I'm just going to give you a little bit of a preview. So let's bring Doom 2 up one more time and show you what things actually look like. So, a lot of replacements. There was an actual... This is an actual scene from one of the maps down the line, where you actually are fighting a cyber demon in that kind of environment. So Thomas Worf made a special intro for this. These are all the credits, of course. It's software, but then you have all of our names in there. And as we start a new game, for example, Ultraviolence, you get to see Memento Mori 2 with a custom status bar, which once again I made for this. Thomas helped. He made it look good in the end, but I did a lot of the legwork for it. Custom music and a whole bunch of other stuff. And this is where I felt like I had, I don't want to say I had arrived, but I really liked that this was the way for me to kind of prove myself to the Doom community, right? I made a Doom mission pack. I wanted to show that I could create something that was just as good as those guys who worked on Memento Mori could do, and I was actually included in this watch, and I got to make what, 4 of the 32 maps. So this is something I want to look at in much more detail next time. We're going to do one more stream tomorrow, and I'm going to play all of my Memento Mori maps. Maybe get to Requiem as well, give you an idea. But until then, so we're pretty much done here. Let's just look at the chat a little bit more, if there's anything else. But I think we're pretty much done. Everybody's shell-shocked enough with, you know, and we've certainly been playing for almost 2 hours here, to where I don't think there are many more comments. So I hope you enjoyed this. I hope there are a few insights in here, or just general ideas as to, you know, what it was like to make those maps back then. Gives you an idea as to how I remember some things. So tomorrow, coming back, let's look at Memento Mori. Let's play those maps and just give you an idea. I think this is pretty much the pinnacle of classic Doom 2 map design. Probably not what you would look at, you know, or consider the pinnacle in today's Doom editing community, but certainly back then. I think Memento Mori 2 is still one of the number one mods which are out there. And that's what I'm going to go back to tomorrow. So thank you so much for stopping by, watching the stream live. I'm going to upload it to YouTube again as well, if you missed part of it in the beginning. Then I hope to see you again tomorrow. I understand tomorrow is a little bit of a weird time. I'm doing this at noon, which for anybody in Europe is, you know, on New Year's night is pretty late already. It's going to be 6 o'clock in Germany, for example, so maybe you're watching it as an archive in the end. But if you do want to join me, just as pretty much one of the last things you do in 2014, then please do so. I'm looking very much forward to seeing you tomorrow, and have a good rest of the day.